the big story of the day. You have one last chance to comply with the new IT rules or face consequences. India's government told Twitter, the global microblogging platform, including the possibility that Twitter could be held accountable for content posted on it, an exemption it currently largely enjoys. But the government has given no deadline for compliance, and this communication came on a day where we saw brief removal of the blue tick verification badge from the personal account of the Vice President Venkaiah Naidu, since it had not been logged into for 6 months. 6 months, the blue tick has now been restored.
The government has given one last chance for microblogging site Twitter to comply with the new IT rules. On a day when the personal account of Vice President Venkaiah Naidu and other RSS leaders had their verification blue ticks removed for being inactive over a period of time, this was eventually reversed. On Sunday morning, the new flashpoint between government and Twitter emerged, with Twitter removing blue tick verification badges on Vice President Venkaiah Naidu's personal account. Along with Naidu, RSS Chief Mohan Bhagwat and his colleagues Suresh Soni, Arun Kumar, Suresh Joshi and Krishna Kumar also lost the verification badges. After an outcry, Twitter restored the blue tick on their accounts. Sources in the microblogging site explained that with the new verification policy, those accounts that were inactive over a period of time had the blue tick removed. It was restored when it was brought to their attention.
1925 से लगातार लगभग 100 वर्ष हो गए राष्ट्रीय स्वयं सेवक संघ को काम करते और हमें किसी की ब्लू टिक होने से ना होने से भारतीय जनता पार्टी के संघ के राष्ट्रवादी विचार के प्रवाह को कोई नहीं रोक सकता।
ट्विटर जब किसी एक हैंडल को वेरीफाई करता है तो उसका एक ड्यू प्रोसेस है, उसमें वो बहुत सारी चीजें मांगते हैं, बहुत सारी फॉर्मेलिटीज करनी पड़ती हैं और उसके बाद वो जो ट्विटर हैंडल है वो वेरीफाई होता है। अब यदि ब्लू टिक हटा है तो इसका भी एक कारण जो है वो ट्विटर को बताना चाहिए किस कारण से ये ब्लू टिक हटाया गया है। ये मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि एक प्रकार का डिजिटल सामंतवाद है जो ट्विटर जैसी कंपनीज जो है वो भारत में चलाना चाहती हैं।
Minutes after this controversy, the center shot off a letter to Twitter to comply with the new IT rules immediately. It says, "We are dismayed to note that your responses neither address the clarifications sought nor indicate full compliance with the rules. Provide the details of the Chief Compliance Officer, further Resident Grievance Officer and Nodal Contact Person nominated by you is not an employee of Twitter Inc. in India as prescribed in the rules. As a gesture of goodwill, Twitter Inc. is hereby given one last notice to immediately comply with the rules. Failing which, the exemption from liability available under Section 79 of the IT Act shall stand withdrawn and Twitter shall be liable of consequences as per the IT Act and other penal laws of India."
While every social media platform has to confine with the laws that exist in our country and has to face the jurisprudence in this country, the reality is that the Modi government has made this an ego issue and it is not going to be able to resolve this matter. The reality also is that a lot of things that this government is doing is being done with an intention to undermine the freedom of speech and expression, to curb free speech, to intimidate people.
When contacted by NDTV, Twitter declined to comment. The government has sent a clear warning to Twitter. It is to be seen, like WhatsApp, will Twitter also take the government to courts over the new IT rules? With Arvind Gunasekhar, Osama Shab for NDTV.
So, a warning to comply but no deadline by when to? Is this a power move? Joining us on the show, Jitin Jain, cybersecurity expert, Aprameya Radhakrishna, CEO and co-founder of Ku, the Indian social networking site, Shreya Singhal, advocate, Pavan Duggal, cyber law expert and advocate. Pavan Duggal, what do you make of this timing? Are the two related? Is it a mere coincidence that this new communique came minutes after Venkaiah Naidu's personal account that he had not used for over 6 months was unticked?
Clearly, there's a connection between both the events because they cannot be seen in independent isolation. But having said that, I don't think that the letter of the government is on good sound footing for the very simple reason it's actually saying that as a goodwill gesture, we are asking you one last time to comply, otherwise it will be withdrawn. When you look at Rule 7 of the Information Technology Rules 2021, it's very clear that Twitter's exemption from statutory liability under Section 79 of the IT Act has already stood withdrawn. This is also in pursuance of the judgment of the Delhi High Court in the case of X versus Union of India delivered in April 2021. So there's no question of one last opportunity we are giving as a goodwill gesture, only then will be withdrawn. The legal propositions are very clear. The legal principles are very clear. Their statutory exemption from legal liability stands withdrawn. Number two, which means they are now exposed to all kinds of legal consequences. The honeymoon of these kind of players were under the Indian cyber law, as they were enjoying it for the last one decade, has now come to an end. And now it's just staring off stark ground realities. In addition, I believe that now the decks are all cleared for the criminal prosecution of all service providers who have not yet complied with law. Hmm. But ultimately, whether criminal prosecution will take place or will not take place will be dependent upon the political will of the relevant government. Currently, it's more trying to be vacillating because it's saying we are giving you one last opportunity. Look, under law, there are no last opportunities. You either comply with law or you do not comply with law.
So then perhaps this is a power move because you're saying it's not even required. We've gone way beyond that. But Apramaya Radhakrishna, you know, Ku certainly, I'm sure, is enjoying this, laughing all the way to the bank. But you run a microblogging site. Do you believe, I mean, there's a real human person sitting there and checking and unticking these accounts? I mean, a third-party agency hired to do these checks? Or is it not? Aren't these like automated bots, a program, a software that basically uses a formula? If you see no activity for 6 months, you untick. I mean, surely how does Ku do it?
So I'll just give you an idea of why we verify, the fundamental behind verifying. People of eminence from various sectors of the society, they will be searched on the platform, on our platform, for example, and there will be other people with similar names. So in order for users to be able to find the person of eminence who is most searched, you will verify certain people so that it is easier.
About unverifying, unticking.
Yeah, so this is the process of verification. Now, activity or inactivity is not something that we consider because a person of eminence is always a person of eminence. Whether they're active or inactive, the users on Ku will want to come and follow irrespective of activity on the platform. It is the user's prerogative, right? So at least on Ku, we do not consider the amount of activity to verify or unverify, right? So that's where we come.
Okay. Shreya Singhal, Pawan Dugal says, you know, we've gone beyond the legal, taking this to the court, etc. WhatsApp has taken this issue to court. The government seems to be preempting that option at all when it says we're leaving Twitter with the option of, it's not leaving Twitter with the option of going to court like WhatsApp, because it says just either comply or we'll withdraw this protection, which Pawan Dugal points out has already been done.
I do agree with that. It's giving Twitter no choice, but at the end of the day, it's giving the people no choice, because the government has gotten so insecure that it cares more about blue ticks than actual governance or doing anything else. And it's not a Twitter versus government. It's a Twitter versus a private person, a private company. And at the end of the day, it is the people who are using Twitter. It's you and me and everyone else who's using Twitter, which has become one of the largest platforms, social media platforms in India. So you can't deny that. At the end of the day, the losers are going to be the common man.
Well, let's also remember it's a day when 3,380 Indians have died due to the spread of the coronavirus. And then we're seeing our governments more busier with responding to the fact that an unused account, a private account of the vice president has been unticked, etc. So that kind of puts it in perspective. Sorry, go ahead. Go ahead, Shreya.
And if you see what has happened, how Twitter has been used in the last month and a half, and the most brutal month and a half that everyone has seen in India, how people have reached out, complete strangers have sought to help other strangers just out of humanity. And the reach has been through social media. So that is what is important. That is the larger picture. And yes, if the rules have come in place, Twitter must comply with them until there is a stay on the rules, or the rules are set aside, or, you know, the effect of them is set aside with complying with due process. That is what is important.
Let's not deify Twitter either. Yes, of course, in the second wave, etc. Twitter has its own faults, as we've seen politically, globally, the world over. But Jitin Jain, where is Twitter facing a problem in accepting which guideline and why?
You know, if you look at this blue tick issue at all, I don't think we should get into it because I don't think Twitter is being transparent because inactivated accounts of people like Ahmed Patel or Honorable former President Pranab Mukherjee are still blue tick verified. So I don't think this 6 month policy stands for any ground. And these things are not automated. Verification is never automated. It is done manually. Removals are also done manually because these are, you know, selective issues. Anyways, coming to the, you know, issue of Twitter refusing to comply with the IT rules. See, the major confrontation is happening at two scales. One, Twitter does not want to appoint three resident officers in India who are the employees of Twitter. Because once they do that, it is not the question of, you know, salary of three people. It will, create a whole network of legal accountability in India. Today, the letter sent by Delhi Police to Twitter MD, he had replied that to Gaspar, nothing to do with Twitter US. So you are from the wrong door, buddy. Please go and find someone else. So now these sort of arguments have been given by all big tech companies in the last few years in different legal forums, including the Delhi High Court and Supreme Court, that subsidiaries which are operating in India, Twitter India and all those things have got nothing to do with Twitter US. These people go in parliament, take awards, make policies, give ads, come on your TV, have a bio of Twitter India and Twitter, all those things. But whenever there is a legal process, they say that, look, we have got nothing to do with Twitter, which is the facade, and which is why government wanted to do away with this entire confusion and wanted to ensure that Twitter US has to employ three officers in India who are residents of India, because today the grievance officer is sitting in Ireland who does not even have a mobile number. So imagine a country which gives you 40% revenue, 50 crore user base, you don't even want to have three salaries of three people. Actually, what Twitter is trying to do, they are trying to change the world order. They want to have a new world order where the laws made by sovereign parliament of sovereign countries have to be approved by a self-appointed viceroy, Mr. Jack Dorsey of East India Company Twitter. Now, this is the problem, that they want to get into the interference of lawmaking process, which is a sovereign right of a sovereign government in countries across the world. To take the example of Australia, where Google was trying to literally bully the Australian Prime Minister, Australian Parliament, threatening Australian Parliament of misinformation. But finally, they ended up complying. These are bullies. If you give them back, they will comply. Look at the example of a small, tiny country, an African country like Nigeria, where Twitter had the audacity to delete the tweet of a president. Now, the question
Action taken against Donald Trump after he was...
This is the question. Can a private individual sitting in a corporate boardroom in California try and control or influence the political discourse of sovereign nations? This is not a question of Donald Trump, Narendra Modi or Nigerian president. Now, the question is, that if they do it, would you allow a private company to today decide that who will speak what? I mean, silencing that Donald Trump's account without any legal order, without any court order, or without any law enforcement agency.
But Jitin Jain, for argument's sake, with 68 million followers for Prime Minister Modi, surely the BJP too has tried to use internet platforms to formulate India's politics.
You see, now, this is what I'm saying, that, you know, this whole argument that, I mean, Twitter has done a lot of good work in pandemics and all, but, you know, 100 donations cannot absolve you from accountability of a murder. So, private accounts of political office holders like Prime Minister, President, you can't say that these are private accounts. Donald Trump's account was a notified designated official account of White House. So, same for India. He may move away with his account. These are done because when Narendra Modi retired, he can retain his private account and PMO India will be transferred to the next Prime Minister. But that does not mean that Twitter... can remove his account or block his account. The question.
Okay, so what next? Pavan Dugal, where do we go? Banning Twitter is not a solution. Neither is accepting, not regulating big foreign, big tech companies to comply with local rules.
Way forward is very, very simple.
Just one line.
Sorry, Pavan. Jitin, please finish.
Just one line. We have to ask all of us, a bigger question. Does big tech have a right to censor a sovereign? It is not a question of censoring you or me. Can they censor a sovereign? They deleted tweets of Iranian president, Supreme Leader, American president, tomorrow team is, I mean, but Chinese embassy.
This is also, Jitin Jain, this has also come on a day when Twitter informed a cartoonist that the government has informed them that they have to censor his account. So Twitter says you are not protecting freedom of speech. Can we trust the government to protect our freedom?
No, I fully agree with you, Sarah. And this is my advice to the government. All the requests for any censorship or any deletion which are sent by government under such a process, in a time-bound manner, maybe after 6 months or 4 months, they must be put in public domain with the reasons. I think I'm all for that transparency. Government has done it in the past. In case of Chinese app, they did issue a detailed press release through PIB, noting down the reasons. I think same could be done for this thing. They could not be done immediately because of law enforcement issues, but maybe after 6 years or after a year. And this IT rules, by the way, has a specific provision that if you face a censorship or problem, even from the government, you can complain and have an opportunity to be heard. And this is a part of IT rules, that anybody who thinks that they have been wrongly censored or blocked, they have a right to appeal to the government, they have a right to appeal to this private company. And this clause will empower the private citizens of India.
Who's in jail for a joke he actually never made on a public platform? How is he supposed to challenge any of this? But I want to go across to Pawan Dugal, please. What is the solution then? What is the way forward? How do you find that middle ground between not banning Twitter and also getting these big foreign tech firms to comply with local laws?
I think Indian government has been way too soft with these intermediaries, and the interpretation given by the Supreme Court in 2015 has effectively been misinterpreted so as to for these service providers to say, look, your Supreme Court says be a spectator, don't do anything till such time you get a court order or an order from a governmental agency. That has effectively been misused extensively for the last 5 years. Now, the way going forward is very simple. India needs to stick to its guns, which is to say you either comply or you leave India. Just as what other service providers are telling Indian users that, look, you comply with my amended privacy policy or leave. Well, once you give that particular strong message, and once, look, India is such a huge market. No company in their sane senses would want to leave India. But in case, if they are not willing to comply, then go ahead with criminal prosecution. Maybe it's just going to be one test case. But once that test case is coming across, a message of deterrence is going to come across. I agree that this is going to be a slightly kind of a hard dosage or a medicine for all of us to take. But then if this is important for purposes of reiterating Indian cyber sovereignty, I'm all for it. Primarily because if we are actually going to be still on the request mode, despite having the IT rules as mandatory, then I think we are doing nothing but transforming these IT rules 2021 into just being mere paper tigers. Of course, there are problems in the IT rules 2021. There's a need for far more checks and balances. Those are things that the Delhi High Court and maybe even the Supreme Court could potentially adjudicate at a later stage. But right now, when these rules are very crystal clear, until such time there's no stay, there are no options but to comply.
Otherwise, you have to comply. How does one regulate? Leaves us, of course, with this question. How does one regulate online content? Do big multinationals not have to face some sort of degree of local scrutiny or accountability on the ground in every country that they provide services in? Thank you all for joining us for this fascinating, well-rounded discussion. If I may say so myself, thank you all for joining us tonight.